one of the things that I try to do during the times that we have at gathering is to have someone, a girl, a lady, somebody to share the word from a woman's perspective. And so usually that person is Kelly, because she's adept at doing these things because of fire ministries and stuff like that. She loves the Lord. She has a heart for the Lord. And so, you know, she's under the covering of Life in the Spirit. And, you know, if anybody's offended at a woman, she's not trying to correct you guys. So just sit back, let the Spirit of God speak. Just hear from the Spirit. And she also has a lot of little videos and stuff, I think, don't you? And those videos will speak, and they're neither male nor female. And it shouldn't matter to us. We just want the word. So we want the Lord. And so let's pray. Father, we just look to you. Our ears are open to your Spirit. Our hearts are open to your heart. Father, we stand ready at all times, under any circumstances, to be able to receive what you want to say to us. And we are weak, and we are broken, and we are open, and we're glad to be weak, because when we're weak, you're strong. We're glad to be broken, because you're our completion, and you're our fullness. And we love to be together. Father, look upon us. We love to be together. We love to gather at Jesus' feet and to let him speak, and let the wings of the Spirit of God bring the reality of that to us. So have your way and be glorified. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Kelly, come share with
me. Well, I just first want to say thank you so much for the invitation from Randy and Debbie to share Jesus. And if I do share anything that's out of line or not the Lord, please, it's not them, it's me. And I pray that that truly the Holy Spirit will be the one just speaking to my heart and all of our hearts, and the things that are in his heart today will just light us up. I wanted to mention that, you know, there's times where I'm sitting in a class, and that's not what this is, but I'm just listening for the heart of Jesus. That's all that matters. And when the Holy Spirit takes that and ignites my heart, ignites the living one within, all of a sudden it's like I'm not even there anymore. I'm just with them. Like what Bibi was, the beautiful thing she shared in worship. It's like all of a sudden you're just with them. You're not in the room. You're not in some different foreign nation or a Zoom call. You're with the Lamb, and only the Spirit can do that, and the Son who is within us. So I pray that this morning is a time of life and of being with him, and that the things that I just submit to you will minister. So I'm going to begin now, and the title of this is called The Candlestick Altar. We are working with a PowerPoint presentation along with some videos. So the title for our discussion today is The Candlestick Altar in Revelation. The Candlestick Altar in Revelation. We're just going to look at a few scriptures in the book of Revelation to begin with. And the Spirit told John the Apostle when he was on the island of Patmos to write what you see. So we're just going to read a few of those verses in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him. And it's this word here, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. Revelation chapter 1 verse 2, who bear record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. Verse 7, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him. And they also which pierced him, all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Verse 19, write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall be hereafter. And then verse 11, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And write what you see. Write what you see. Write it in a book. Send it to the seven churches. So here it is. God says to John, write what you see and put it in a book and send it to the seven churches. Send it to the candlesticks. Write what you see and send what you saw to candlesticks. Write what you see and then send what you saw to candlesticks. Send what you see to candlesticks. Write what you see. The time for teaching is over. When candles are lit, then they see. What do they see? They see Jesus, the Lamb, in their midst. Candles were not meant to be taught, but ignited with fire. When the candles are lit, they will see. What will they see? The one in their midst. This is the book of Revelation. We're just looking at the scriptures. Hallelujah. Candlesticks are not chalkboards. They're not meant to be written on, math equations and teachings on. Candles are meant to be lit. Candles are meant to be lit. And when God told John to write what he saw, he didn't say write it on chalkboards. He said put it in a book for the seven candlesticks to be lit up by. We're just going to really quickly look at this verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Nevertheless, when the heart shall turn towards the Lord, the veil will be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into that same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. When our hearts turn, our eyes see. When our hearts turn, our eyes, it seems so simple. We do it with the children all over Ireland, and we've done it here in Texas. They have this dance where we have a big heart that says, turn, 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 all the way. And it's a song being sung to the Apostle John, who's Gideon. But nonetheless, he's just saying, you got to turn all the way, all the way. And then we have a girl going, no, turn all the way. Because then you're going to see him and not just hear. And that's what happened in the book of Revelation to the Apostle John. Must turn to see. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Boy, I tell you what, that's good enough for me sometimes. I'm like, I'm in the Spirit. I'm not in the soul. And maybe parents really can feel that way when they get to church after that drive. I don't know. But even though it was John the Apostle who had followed Jesus his whole life, 90 plus years, being in the Spirit on the Lord's day was still not the right position for what God had for those candlesticks. It says the next half of the sentence that he heard behind him, a great voice as of a trumpet. that trumpet was saying, John, turn, turn, turn your heart all the way. There's something incredible that you want to see. You got to see this. You can't go any further till you see it. You got to see what I want to show you. And you got to let the churches be ignited with what you're going to see. You may think you're in the spirit, but you got to turn, turn, turn. And that's what he did. Verse 12. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw, what did he see? 7 golden candlesticks. 7 golden candlesticks. And in verse 17, and when I saw him, I fell as at his feet as dead. So there's a lot of turning happening in the first chapter of Revelation, because there's a lot of fire that's going to be coming later on in the book. We call it a great adventure with the children. John's about to go on a great adventure. The 7 churches are going to go on a great big adventure. But if they don't turn, turn, turn all the way to see, not just be taught, then they're not going to be ready for that great adventure. Turn, turn all the way. God's getting his churches ready for the great adventure called the Book of Revelation, which is really a whole bunch of fiery trials to bring forth the sun. But like Pastor Randy shared with us last night, we can't be with him in those fiery trials if we have a wrong concept of what the fire is. So God's trying to get his churches ready for the real fire, and that requires seeing Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to read an excerpt from something that Randy shared a long time ago. And as I was preparing this, I woke up one morning and this was playing on my recording that I sometimes have going, and it just fit right in. It says, many times we are so used to hearing only teaching instead of seeing the face of Jesus. But when we do, our darkness will be so pierced by his face that we'll be changed forever into his image. It is the light of the knowledge of the glory of God that cannot be preached. It has no power unless it pierces our darkness, piercing the darkness and not just teaching the darkness. For that light to be so powerful, that light is not in the preacher's face. That light is not in John the Apostle's face. That light is in Jesus' face. Hallelujah. A light that pierces the darkness. A light that changes us into his image and lights the candle of our spirit with his nature. Hallelujah. When John turned and he saw those 7 candlesticks, I want to read the verses that really define the man in the middle that John beheld when his heart turned all the way. And this is going to be in verses 13 through 16 in the book of Revelation. And in the midst of the 7 candlesticks, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot and girt about the waist with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire. This is the man in the middle of the 7 branch candlestick. His feet were like unto fine brass, as if they had been burned in a furnace, his voice the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. His countenance was as the sun, shining in his strength. And I just noted that his face shined as bright as the sun in its strength. He's shining really bright in the altar, and John's beholding it. The man in the midst is a person. That's what John saw, not a doctrine. He saw a person, not a teaching. He saw a person, not a commandment. He saw a person, not a ministry. He saw a person with a heart. A person appearing in their midst that wants to bring them in. Bring them into all that's to come by glorious oneness. A person with a desire for us to be with him. A person with a heart that longs after us and is gathering and drawing us in. And this was our first video is going to touch on that.
Tell you that I love you. I love you. But I can't think of right words to say. I long to tell you that I'm always thinking of you. I'm always thinking of you. But my words just blow away. Ends up to one thing, honey, and I can't think of right words to say. Wherever I am, girl, I'm always walking with you. I'm always walking with you, but I look and you're not there. Whoever I'm with, I'm always, always talking to you. I'm always talking to you, and I'm sad that you can hear. Sad that you can. It always ends up to one. Honey, when I look and you're not there. Around you, like sea around the shore. Each night and day I pray, and hope that I might find you, and hope that I might find you, because hearts can do no more. Do. It always ends up to one. Honey, still I kneel upon the floor. How can I tell you that I love you? I love you, but I can't think of right words to say. I long to tell you that I'm always thinking of you. I'm always thinking of you. It always ends up to one thing, honey, and I can't think of right words to say.
He always gets me. Maybe we can just pray. Lord, you're in my midst, in our midst, Jesus. I just want to hear your heart. Oh, Jesus. We just want to hear your heart.
Oh, Lord, you're right here in our midst. You're a person. You're right here, Jesus. You're right here. Your heart is so beautiful. It's so full. It's so broken and fragile and never declares itself. Never shouts its needs. Oh, Lord. When we look into your eyes by the Spirit of God, we look into your heart. You're all that matters. And your heart for your Father, the things of the Spirit. Oh, Lord, I know I want so much more sensitivity to you. So much more sensitivity by the Spirit of God to you, the person, and by you to the Father, the person. Oh, my Father, I thank you for sending the Holy Spirit to give me his sensitivity, to fill me with his sensitivity. And the way he knows the heart of Jesus and knows the depths of the heart of God and brings them to me in ways that aren't teaching, but ways that can light me up with his nature and bring him what he needs. Oh, Lord, we're like those candlesticks crying out to see the one in our midst in the way he needs to be seen. And we need the Holy Spirit to be able to see him in the way he needs to be seen. So we ask you, Holy Spirit, to help us, even as you did being the oil in the candlesticks. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit, for being that oil to help us be ignited. You're beautiful. All of you are beautiful. So we turn our hearts away from teaching and need and ourselves in the earth to the wonder of your being, all three in one. Oh, we're here for you. We're so here for you and through you, with you and in you. Let that be so real to you, this gathering and beyond. Let it be so real to you. It's our heart cry. It's our heart cry for your sake. Hallelujah. Oh. You know, everything in the tabernacle was an altar, but it would take some time to go through Leviticus and Exodus and the places where you can perceive that through just spending some time searching it out. But, you know, the vessels were altars in the sense that they were gold and silver that had been melted down and had all the dross removed and were made in a practical way available for God, to vessels for God. The table of showbread was wheat seed that had been crushed and beaten and made into bread through the fire. And but for this candlestick altar, the Holy Spirit is being offered up so that the light can come to the churches to see Jesus. I mean, the person of the Holy Spirit is being offered up in every candlestick. That oil in the candlestick is being consumed so the light will come to the churches, so that the living Lamb will be ignited on the altars of their heart. He's offering himself up. He's being consumed for the churches to know Jesus in the way that Jesus can be their life. Oh, how precious is this altar, this candlestick altar, where as we look closely, we'll see the Holy Spirit being offered up inside of each candlestick so that Jesus can be seen. John saw the candlestick altar. One may ask, what is being offered up on this candlestick altar? The Holy Spirit is being offered up so that light can come to the churches to see Jesus. The oil always represents the Holy Spirit, and the light represents the Lord. And so the oil, the Holy Spirit, is giving himself to be burned up in the candlesticks so that Jesus, the light, can be seen and shine in them and through them.
In Leviticus 24, verse 2, it says, command the children of Israel that they bring unto thee pure olive oil beaten for the light to cause the lamps to burn continually. Bring unto thee oil, pure olive oil, beaten for the light to cause the lamps to burn continually. Oh, how precious is that oil, and how beautiful is the light. The Spirit of God and the Lamb of God. When the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost, the fire also came, making altars out of everyone, and they became the golden candlesticks, able to receive Spirit-imparted light, to really see the Lamb who was now in them as their light, their life, their nature. So the candlestick altar relates to light, seeing, knowing. Hallelujah. This one's called Lamb Light is Needed. The churches have light on the subject of Jesus and ministry. The seven churches did, but they did not have the light that ignites them as candles to bear his fire and be with him in the flames. They will need this light to be overcomers in the adventure they're about to go through. The old kind of light will no longer suffice, but the light that comes from the altar fire, the light that comes from knowing him in this way, will do more than all the lessons and teachings they had ever known before. Hallelujah. We're going to go to another video in a minute. We're just going to look at these questions. What is the Spirit saying to the candlesticks in these verses from Revelation chapter 1? Who is the Spirit revealing in their midst? And what is the fire meant to bring them into? If we hear the Spirit of it, then we see him and enter in. Hallelujah. Jesus begins and ends with love in his letters to the churches. And I'm going to just read these verses from Luke chapter 10. And this is hearkening back to a sharing that Pastor Randy did in Ireland in 2019. It's the last time we met for our conference in Ireland. And Pastor Randy shared from the story of the Good Samaritan there, and it was more than a sharing. We all felt it was something from the heart of the Lord that was on the Lord's heart for us. And I felt from the Lord to just kind of bring that back in a way that was kind of in flow with the spirit of this gathering. So I'm just going to read those verses, and then we're going to watch a quick video on the Good Samaritan. So we're in Luke chapter 10, verse 27. Jesus said that to inherit eternal life, and the greatest of all commandments, was to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, with all thy strength, with all thy mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And then in the following verses, Jesus shared the story after he spoke of love in this way. Then he shared the story of the Good Samaritan. Let us contemplate this story in regards to the person in this story who has light to see the one who was beaten and left for dead, to see the Lamb, to see the crucified Christ, to see the one in the midst, and who went into the flames to be with him in his suffering. Let us contemplate this story of the Good Samaritan in regards to one who, like a candle, had light to see the one who was beaten and left for dead, even as a picture of Christ crucified, and who went to be with this one in the flames, to fellowship with him in his suffering. So we'll watch that video now.
Oh! and by chance, there came down a certain priest that way. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him. He saw him, he had compassion on him.
Let's just take a moment to pray after that one, too. Lord, we long to have our candle lit so we can see you. Lord, the Levite or the priest didn't really see you, but the Samaritan, he had eyes to see you and to pour the oil and to pour the wine in, to come into the flames with you, to see, Lord, not the problems, not the shame, not the betrayal, not the personal lack or injury or cost, but to see you, to come to you, to pour in oil, to pour in wine, to fellowship with you in your sufferings. Lord, this is why we want to see. We want to see the Lamb. We want to be with him where he's at, on his altar, fellowshipping, ministering to him, loving the Lord our God with all our heart, all our soul, all our strength, all our mind, and our neighbor as ourselves in that same spirit. What we've done to the least, we've done to you, Jesus. We want to behold you, even if it's the one we've pierced, and come to you in love, and be with you, and minister to you. We want eyes to see Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You know, it's funny that in the seven letters that Jesus had John write to the churches, the first letter had to do with love. That's the church to the Ephesians, and how they had fallen from their first love. And the last church had to do with love, the Laodicean church, where they were neither hot nor cold. They were just indifferent to the Lord. And they were advised to buy gold tried in the fire to get that first love back, to bring that fire back. And you can see how love is a theme in the heart of Jesus. You know, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot, but buy of me gold tried in the fire, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve. This is the words of Jesus to the candlestick called Laodicea. Buy of me gold tried in the fire, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, to see him, to be with him. Hallelujah. I have a fiery love, light the candle. Fire brings the love back. It's the secret ingredient. I think if you really look through 1 Peter, you'll see a recipe for loving the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and strength. And there is an ingredient of loving not your soul, but loving the Lord more than anything, and having it tested in the flames, and reaching his heart and reaching the Father's heart through him. I'm just going to read this verse from 1 Peter, and then we're going to watch our last video. This is 1 Peter 4, 12 through 13. It is not a real paraphrase, and it's very loosely translated, so I pray your mercy and forgiveness in this translation, but to maybe just to hear a heart behind it. To those who are loved in the Beloved, don't think you're rejected when fires show up in the form of trials, as if you're being hated instead of pursued and desired. But let your heart be ignited, because Jesus is allowing you to be with him in what is most sacred and precious to his heart. Take his sufferings into you so deeply that his glorious being appears and shines in you, and joy floods you to overflowing. I'm going to read that first line again. To those who are loved in the Beloved, don't think you're rejected when fires show up in the form of trials, as if you're being hated instead of pursued and desired. But let your heart be ignited, because Jesus is allowing you to be with him in what is most sacred and precious to his heart. Hallelujah. Let his fire ignite first love. Come unto him in those flames, and let love burn strong. And so our final video is another return to the things the Lord has shared with us in years past through Pastor Randy. About 3 years ago, he shared during one of our gatherings from Mary of Bethany, and something that was so powerfully from the heart of Jesus that the sharing from Mary of Bethany has continued till this very day. And just a week ago or so, Pastor Randy shared again in regards to this gathering something from the heart of the Lord about Mary of Bethany. And I took the recording of that very sharing from Pastor Randy and put it into this slideshow, followed by a song that will hopefully minister to your heart for Jesus.
She has her hand on the doorknob of the corridor, and she's going through it. She's worrying. She's wondering. She doesn't know everything. Standing there, as I said, trembling and going, well, will she choose the sufferings of Christ? Well, we know the answer to that, don't we? Mary does what? She goes into the fire where Jesus is. She goes into the fire where Jesus is. And her heart took her there. She doesn't avoid the fire. She could have. But her strong motivation was that she wanted to be with Jesus, the young minister, more than anything. And so, as I said, she doesn't avoid the fire. I mean, there is the fire. You see, if it was just a situation where he was somewhere else and you could just approach him, there wouldn't be no fire. Or if you were in a group that approached him. But in this situation, she knows. She knows the fire that's about to happen. And she has to make that decision. Is this what I'm going to do? And all of the things, as I was talking about, that was going through her mind when that was coming up. So she goes in, and she knows what she's going to face. She's going to face accusations. She's going to face accusers. But she wants to be with him. She wants to be with Jesus where he's at, and he just happens to be in the fire. You know. And so all of the worries, all of the thoughts, all of the fears, all of the questions, all of the what about this is and what about that and, you know, how's this going to work out and everything, it just begins to be overshadowed by the fact that I got 2 days and this is my shot. And even if it means I have to go into the fire to be with him, I've got to be there. I've got to be there. And when she goes in, she went straight to Jesus. Straight to Jesus.
Amen. I look in your eyes and I can see you love so dangerously. You're not trusting your heart to anyone.
You tell me you're gonna play it smart. We're through before we start, and I believe that we've just begun.
But when it's this good, there's no saying no.
I need you so, I'm ready to go.
Through the fire, to the limit, to the wall. For a chance to be with you, I'd gladly risk it all.
Through the fire, through whatever come what may. Chance to be with you, I'd take it all the way,
right down to the wire,
even through the fire. You touch me in something and need do what I could have with you. I am not ready to kiss that dream goodbye.
Ooh, but when it's this sweet, there's no saying no.
I want you so, I'm ready to go.
The limit to the wall. For a chance to be with you, I'd gladly risk it all. Ooh.
Through the fire, to whatever come what may. For a chance to be with you, I'd take it all the way.
Right down to the wall.
down to the wire, even through the fire.
Right down to the wire,
even through the fire. Right down to the wire, girl, even through the fire.
Even through.